ओके, लेट अस स्टार्ट अगेन. थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ आवर ए वी. वी कम अप टू दिस लाइन. टू हुम द कुक हैड बीन इंसोलेंट बिकॉज द हाउसमेड हैड एंसर्ड हर बैक. वी इन्फेक्ट द वर्ल्ड विथ आवर इल ह्यूमर्स, बैड मैनर्स, प्रोबेबली डू मोर टू पॉइजन द स्ट्रीम ऑफ द जनरल लाइफ देन ऑल द क्राइम्स इन द कैलेंडर. कैलेंडर मीन्स अ कैलेंडर ऑफ causes arranged for trial in court. For one wife who gets a black eye. Now, here black eye means dishonor. Black eye means dishonor or shame is known as black eye. For one wife who gets a black eye from an otherwise good natured husband, there are 100 who live a life of martyrdom. Martyrdom means the death or suffering of a martyr. त्याला आपण होतात्म्य असं म्हणतो. तर अशा असंख्य स्त्रिया आहेत की ज्यांना आपले हजबंड जे असतात ते अपमान करतात, सन्मान करत नाही, म्हणून त्या ठिकाणी ब्लॅक आय हा शब्द वापरलेला आहे. For one wife who gets a black eye from an otherwise good-natured husband, there are 100 who live a life of martyrdom under the shadow of a morose temper. Morose means unhappy. Here, word is given. Morose is given there. Morose means unhappy. Tasha anek sriya ahet ki ja unhappy ahet ya arthane. But all the same, the law cannot become the guardian of our private manners. No decalogue. Decalogue stands for the 10 commandments. It is called as Adnavali. The 10 commandments. No decalogue could cover the vast area of offenses and no court could administer a law which govern our social civilities. Our speech, the tilt of our eyebrows, tilt stands for, tilt means to move into a sloping position. टू मूव इन टू अ स्लोपिंग पोजिशन, झुकणे, कलणे या अर्थाने. टिल्ट ऑफ आवर आयब्रोज अँड ऑल आवर मूड्स अँड मॅनर्स. नाऊ वी टर्न टू नेक्स्ट पॅरा. बट डो वी आर बाउंड टू एंडोर्स द व्हर्डिक्ट अगेन्स्ट द लिफ्ट मॅन, मोस्ट पीपल विल हॅव अ सर्टन सिम्पथी विथ हिम. वेल, इट इज ट्रू दॅट देर इज no law that compels us to say please. There is a social practice much older and much more sacred than any law which enjoins us to be civil, and the first requirement of civility is that we should acknowledge a service. Please and thank you are the small changes with which we pay our ways as social beings. They are the little courtesies by which we keep the machine of life oiled and running sweetly. They put our intercourse upon the basis of a friendly cooperation, an easy give and take instead of on the basis of superiors dictating to inferiors. It is a very vulgar mind that would wish to command where he can have the service for asking and have it with the willingness and good feeling instead of a resentment. In this paragraph, the writer, he told us about necessarily support the law in the case of the lip man. He want to support the lip man. People will paradoxically feel sympathy for him. Here, sympathy for him. Just because the law cannot compel us to use expressions such as please does not mean that we can do away with customs that are more sacred than even the law. One such custom of civilized man is to acknowledge a service. Gardiner says that here, words like please and thank you. Gardiner says that the words like please and thank you are the small coins we pay on our journey through life as a civilized human beings living in a civil society. These courtesies allows us to live in society without friction. Here, the word is given. oiled and frictions. Oil and frictions. We keep the machine of life oiled and running sweetly. These courtesies allow us to live in society without friction. Besides, these words help to keep cooperation between human beings on a level of friendliness and goodwill. Instead of dividing us into superiors who order and inferiors who are ordered about, the author says that only a vulgar person will order for a service which he can have by mercilessly asking. This is so because a request will provide the service with goodwill. An order might provide the service, but only with resentment. Now, next paragraph. I should like to feature in this connection my friend, the polite conductor. By this discriminating title, I do not intend to suggest a rebuke to conductors generally. On the contrary, I am disposed to think that there are few classes of men who come through the ordeal of very trying calling better than bus conductors do. Here and there you will meet an unpleasant specimen who regards the passengers as his natural enemies. As the creatures whose chief purpose on the bus is to cheat him and who can only be kept reasonably honest by a loud voice and an aggressive manner. But this type is rarer than it used to be. I fancy the public owes much to the Underground Railway Company, which also run the buses, for insisting on a certain standard of civility in its servants and taking care that standard is observed. In doing this, it not only makes things pleasant for the travelling public, but performs an important social service. It is not therefore with any feeling of unfriendliness to conductors as a class that I pay a tribute to a particular member of that class. I first became conscious of his existence one day when I jumped onto a bus and found that I had left home without any money in my pocket. Everyone has had the experience and knows the feelings, the mixed feelings, which the discovery arouses. You are annoyed because you look like a fool at the best and like a knave at the worst. You would not be at all surprised if the conductor eyed you coldly, as much as to say, "Yes, I know that stale old trick. Now then, off you get." And even if the conductor is a good fellow and lets you down easily, you are faced with necessity of going back and the inconvenience perhaps of missing your train as your engagement. Now here, Gardiner, again we turn to this paragraph. Gardiner then goes on to state that he wishes to hold up the example of a friend of his whom he calls the polite conductor. He hastens to add that by calling a particular conductor polite, he does not mean to imply that all other conductors are impolite. In fact, he says, given the difficult nature of their jobs, most conductors go about their work in a very good-natured manner. There are, of course, exceptions. Here and there, one meets resentful conductors who look upon the passengers as their enemies, who have to be kept in check through aggression. But such specimens are fewer than they used to be, and Gardiner thinks that this is because the Underground Railway Company, who manages bus services, imposes a certain standard of polite behavior in the men who work for them. This, he feels, is an important bit of social service that also benefits the passenger. Having made it clear, he has nothing against conductors in general. Okay, we stop here.